What I like about what you guys do is that you're accessible to people, that you talk to young people, right. that you use these ways to get, because if these conversations happen with young people and teens on a regular basis, it's something they grow up with. Yeah. But if they don't happen there, it's much more difficult to get to someone and tell them conservation's important in their 30s and 40s.
Of course, so you have to think about the ways in which people access the world. You know, what do they drink? What do they eat? What do they wear? But also, who are their social influences? So we did a suite of films called, the series is called Nature Speaking. And these are just these beautiful two-minute films giving voice to the ocean, giving voice to the forest, giving voice to ice. And it's ice telling you what it means to the planet and what it means to you. And then we got great people like Liam Neeson and Edward Norton and Kevin Spacey, Julia Roberts, to narrate these.
Some call me nature. Others call me Mother Nature. I've been here for over 4.5 billion years. 22,500 times longer than you. I don't really need people, but people need me. I have fed species greater than you, and I have starved species greater than you. How you choose to live each day doesn't really matter to me. I am nature. I will go on. I am prepared to evolve. Are you?
I took one of those films, actually two of those films, Liam Neeson, Ice, and then Reese Witherspoon doing Home, to the Paris Climate Conference last year. It was the big meeting of climate change leaders around the world.
I am ice. I move slowly. I keep the world cool. Well, I used to. But humans keep warming this planet. I try to warn you. I send pieces of me thundering into the ocean.
And it really had an impact, because all of a sudden, these delegates were reminded of what's at stake, that Mother Nature actually had a seat at the table. In this case, you know, narrated by, you know, Reese Witherspoon or Marion Cotillard, who's an Oscar winner, French actress in French,
yeah.
Which obviously in the French audience, it made a big deal.
What are some of the projects that you do at Conservation International? Give me an idea of how you work.
So our value proposition is pretty simple. We want to protect that part of nature that has the greatest value to humanity. And then the last part is saving that part of nature that is of most value. So, for example, the Bird's Head Seascape of Indonesia, incredible biodiversity, but also incredibly important to millions of people who rely on that ocean for their food and for protection against storms and typhoons and wave surges and things like that. So protecting that kind of reef, or protecting a watershed above the city of Bogota that provides water for the city, or the heart of the Amazon where indigenous people live, that's the kind of work that we love doing. Policy, sustainable production, and then saving natural capital.
So one of the things I like to do when we have people like yourself that are here,
right,
to talk about what is it in your life, or do you remember the moment that there was a passion that you had for whatever it was, climate or environment or weather or science, that made you think, this is who I want to be in my life? Do you remember, was it one moment or
hard.
A collection?
It's tricky for me. So I was born in Sri Lanka, and my earliest memories were going to the zoo, and I wanted to be a zookeeper. And it was the keeper I wanted to be, because they were the star. They would go back in there, and all of a sudden people, they're not watching the animal. They're watching the guy or the woman next to the animal, right?
Yeah.
That's what the kid wants to be. You don't want to be the pangolin or the elephant or whatever it might be. You want to be that guy.
I get it.
Then my family moved to Africa. And so all of a sudden, I really was immersed in wildlife. There were literally animals behind my house, chimpanzees, colobus monkeys, elephants, things like that. But as a career, no way. You know, I'm Asian. My parents wanted me to go and be a doctor, engineer, accountant, lawyer. It was that kind of very traditional education. And then look who I watched on television. You know, I would watch David Attenborough. His Life on Earth series had just come out. Or Gerald Durrell. You know, most of the people I was seeing on TV, whether it's British TV or American television, pardon me for saying this, but they tended to be white, older guys.
I get it. You're absolutely right.
Often with a clipped British accent.
Yeah.
And there was no way that a guy with brown skin was going to do that. So I might have voiced it as a child, and my parents encouraged it as a hobby, but never as a career. So for me, I faked pre-med for a while, came to the U.S., and then got into genetics, and ended up actually getting a PhD in conservation genetics, which is about as close to that end of things that I
did. Yeah, it's pretty close to your passion,
exactly.
And does what the
exactly.
family wanted at the same
time. And, you know, it took a long time to get respectability among the family. I went back to Sri Lanka with a PhD, and my grandmother was telling her neighbor, in Tamil, our home native language, my grandson is back. He's a doctor now, but not the kind that saves people. She had to add that in. So it is a little bit tricky. Now, it is changing. And you see, you know, National Geographic explorers. You see other people in conservation who represent the spectrum or diversity of human life on Earth.
Yeah.
But I will admit that even now, at most very high-level meetings that I'm in, I am still a bit of a minority. And I think we need to change that. I think we need to encourage more folks to get involved in this because it is the most important issue of our time. And you cannot sit this out. And there are jobs in tech, in advertising, in finance, in biology, in lots of different fields that you can bring to help make the planet a little bit better than you found it.
Now, up next, it's a sweltering summer of record highs.
Regionally, we're seeing these numbers higher, and we're seeing those heat waves get longer, which has impacts.